Hey, Arnold. Hey,
Hey.
okay, now I can hear you. Hold on a second. Let me just get your window up.
Yeah, sure.
Huh, interesting. One second. Window capture Google Hangout. Hey, I have panoramical. Yeah. Okay. And let me set up screen share with you. And what?
Okay.
Think it went to the. Right. Well. Okay. Now, hold on. Let me just go to Twitter and make one more post about the game.
Sure. Okay, we have it in the chat. Friggin' Rorke is one of the programmer of Bokida.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah,
So.
so it's nice he's here because may help like answering some question I cannot.
Right.
Yeah, I watched the Panoramico like Jonathan Blow stream, but I don't know what's the game about.
It's really isn't a game. It's more like a visual audio sound thing. Yeah, it's kind of, I have it and it's hard to explain because it's just a bunch of like shaders mixed with music that you can tweak.
But it's like the music is in the, it's like your own music or is the music
No,
in the
it's
experience?
composed in the it's part of it.
Okay.
Yeah, because it was Fernando and David Kanaga. He Kanaga worked on the Proteus.
Oh, okay.
So anyway, I think volume is good. If it's not, if it's kind of weird, let me know.
Sure,
We
my side, everything is okay.
okay.
I can hear you, I cannot see you, but I can
Oh,
see the game,
you can see
so
the
that's
game. Okay,
cool.
that's important. That's all that matters. So, and you are Arnaud, you are currently you're the designer. Just a brief introduction. You're the designer of the game. You live in
Yeah.
Korea. You're from France.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly. So I'm Arnaud Vanier, I'm French, I'm actually living in Korea, in Seoul. And I'm working on Bokida like since the end of 2012. It was like a student project at first. Then we graded it and we're still working on the game now.
Okay, I
And
think we started around the same time then. I started my project November 2012.
yeah. So yeah, it's around the same time and it's funny, there's like very many like similarities and so it's very very happy that you can try the game and give some good feedbacks about what works in your opinion and what not. So
And in terms of the team size, it's.
at first we were like five because it was like all students from the same school, and then right now we're working like eight people. But the thing is, most of the people have a job, so it's like a side project. We had like one programmer full time, and right now I'm full time on the game. But like this is why we have been like working very slowly, and also like we had like one more sound designer and one person working on the cinematics. Like, so that's basically it.
Cool. And then you said Fugen Blorki is the guy.
Yeah.
Is the programmer on the team?
Yeah, we have two programmer and Fugan is one of them, and we have like we're like two programmers, and for the other, like the thing is like there is no like defined rules, so it
Right.
depends on what the needs and so yeah.
Right. Well, let's go ahead and get started. I'm gonna start a new one. Just yesterday, we did like a
Yeah.
quick audio check.
Don't forget to switch change the keys.
Oh yeah,
it's still French.
Okay, so it's W, S, A, D.
Yeah.
Right. That's all.
It's all good.
Is there audio in this specific scene right now?
Yeah, you can go in the audio. You can change the master volume.
Okay, let me just double check back here. Okay. Right, let's go ahead and get started. And then just a bit of background, I first learned about the game in 2013 through IGN.
Yeah, at the time we did the IGF student submission. We got a honorable mention.
Okay. I just remember going through the list of the all the submissions. Like, it was 800, and I just wrote down the ones I really stood out to me, and this was, I remember there, I only picked out 10, and this was one of them.
Oh, cool. Yeah, so as you can see, the last video we did was October 2013, the last trailer, so we're not that good about making sure everyone know that we are working on the game, so hopefully we have question are you still working on the game?
Yeah. I do, I love in your Facebook page, you guys update that a lot, and you guys do the French and English updates, the bilingual ones.
So, as I mentioned yesterday, the cinematics right now are not really working properly on the game. We have some frame rate problems we have to figure out how to make it work properly.
David Kilmer, he says the smoke looks lovely.
Oh, thanks.
Now, is this a video, or is this being generated runtime?
No, this is a video. This is the person that working on the video, the opening, ending, and everything. So that's all rendered.
I have to say, the aesthetics of the cinematics is very different than that of the game. I also really love the music. That was one of the things that stood out to me. Alright, it just asked me to move my mouse around. And it says, press 1 to use the build tool. Using left click, place a cube in each socket. Yeah, so the intro is very, very different.
Yeah, we wanted something different since we were making pre-render stuff.
Right.
But we're still working on it.
I love the way you have the checklist kind of disappear. I think that's a very nice touch. Well, I'm just going to keep talking, I think, because this has so many similarities with my game, and right away I feel very peaceful and calm. I think you have a really... Yours has a much more uplifting opening. And I think the music has a lot to do with it, too. So, one build. Now, I know one thing you mentioned, I think one time you were in the stream, just kind of curious about the process of how you guys build this. I use ProBuilder. Is this built in Maya and then transferred in?
Exactly.
It is Maya, okay. So, left click. Using the mouse, aim at a cube you just placed. Then hold left click down while dragging your mouse across the horizontal bar. Open the passage. Aim at any cube you already placed, then hold down the left click. While holding down left click, drag your mouse around to fill the door frame. Oh, does this do the antechamber thing where I just, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, it doesn't fill it in. You know how in antechamber, when you can like put it around the, not saying that it should, but
no, it is. Actually, we did this like it was in the first prototype, and actually, I never thought of this being the same like painting mode, like a cube painting in antechamber, but it's exactly the same.
Yeah.
Mechanic.
You know the way in antechamber when you have the, you can like put a bunch of blocks, and if the inside is empty, it'll fill it in and give you more blocks. That might be too much, though. Hold left click down for a wider blade. Rotate.
Yeah, we use the standard Unity shutter, like edge detect.
Cut through.
For the chat.
Yeah. I am curious, though, because the thing is, it's missing a lot of the edges, right? Like here, it's missing.
Yeah.
And is that sort of the effect that you guys... The thing is, it's if you start to do it like mine, it's going to get a lot darker.
Yeah.
You know?
We want it to be like very, very soft and very like subtle.
Yeah.
You just have to see the shapes because it's all gray and it's hard to tell. This is why we also have like the occlusion. Ambient occlusion.
I feel like you could turn up ambient occlusion a lot more, maybe, and not have. Because I think the thing that bugs me a bit about the outline is that, unlike the ambient occlusion, is very consistent, right? Like that one is always there. But I think with these lines, they do come in and out. Like, especially when it's at this point when it does the. You know what I'm saying? It does the switch. Like now the left side. So. And I think because if you're doing it in Maya, then you do your light baking.
The thing is, like, we have big trouble with the light baking in Unity because we are not using the different lighting. We're using the forward rendering because because the different lighting causes a lot of flickering. Because since the game is so huge, there's like I think there's zip buffer problems or whatever, causing a lot of flickering. So because the only render system we can use is forward rendering. We cannot use the bake light and both in the same time. We cannot have like dynamic light and bake light, or we didn't figure it out yet how to do it.
You know, we are about the flickering. Like I have that problem too with my edges, and I'm actually thinking about doing a temporal anti-aliasing shader.
Oh,
which I believe what it does is it samples multiple frames and then blends them together so you lose that flickering. That's something that I'm going to start looking into next week, kind of like breaking down the anti-aliasing. Now, Mainjai asks, can you also do Q and E to rotate the cut? Well, you can't, but he suggested that. Is that something you guys have thought about?
You can change the input if you want.
Oh, you can. Yeah.
So it's like as you like. So if like you want to set up your own, I think the only problem right now is we didn't like since the rotation is on the mouse wheel. If you press the button, if you hold the button, maybe it will rotate too fast. So we have to make sure it's working well. But we have already this setup. So.
Oh, and then I can use 4 as the clean tool. Aim at a surface nearby. Press left click to create a deletion sphere. Oh. Here is the way out. Interesting, normally I'm really bothered by games that have a lot of text, but I'm not so much here. I think maybe because it feels like it's very necessary. You can remap the controls using any,
Yeah, we had a lot of iteration on the tutorial because it used to be way longer and way more texts, and we try to make it more like not too bothering, because the whole game is not like saying a lot of things, so it's a bit weird if the tutorial is like.
So yeah, I think my biggest, so yeah, this, I noticed there's the blue sky. I don't think that used to be there.
We changed this to make the atmosphere look a bit like brighter.
I do think, because I'm not, the edges look, they don't seem to fit well. I think just because it's at the top here, like, I would explore the ambient occlusion. It may be. It's nice that it's a very soft, and it does give a lot. Yeah, it would be. I don't know. It's interesting. Like, I think you guys have a really good look, and it's just like Oh fuck. I remember, like, this is what I did a lot.
Yeah.
The first time I played.
The thing is, right now we have mechanics to, like, restrain you from doing this forever.
Right.
That's not. We just removed it because the tutorial is not working well. So it's like a mechanic that you see at the top of the left, like, screen over the build, tool. You have a bar, like a gray, like almost black bar, and you normally this bar would like get empty as you build, and you will have to like absorb some of what you cut it to refill the bar, and so you cannot build forever. You have to stop sometimes and refill your bar and build again. But since the tutorial for this is not polished enough, it's just deactivated for now.
Hold on a second.
You have some problems?
Just one quick second. Yeah. Anyway, okay. Oh fuck, yeah.
How's the frame rate? Because I'm
the frame rate is good. Sure. I'm running on a 970 GTX GeForce 970. The only time I notice it is when it's when I'm cutting and then the things fall apart.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because it's like a slideshow on the share screen, so I was wondering.
Right, the share screen, that's just Google. I do notice is there ambient occlusion on this stuff? Or
yeah.
There is, okay. Yeah, like when I really, really love this texture when you guys have it placed. Like, I think it's such a nice touch, and it feels really good. I think I think the boxes just pop into place, but having the arrows scale dynamically is a really, really nice touch. And I see right now it's like I can't do it right below me, but I can do this, right?
Well, you can. Normally you can, but maybe you have to, like,
If I'm standing above it, it doesn't let me build. I have to jump, which I think is fine. Um, I don't think this is such a problem. What I love is that even though it's there's no like immediate goals right now, it's all just exploration. It still feels very because just the building of it is a lot of fun. That it makes it makes movement really cool. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like just walking around and building, I think is very pleasant. And it doesn't, I think because you can actually traverse quite a bit of space, it doesn't feel tedious. Although I am curious about stuff like this, so you guys, because my whole game is on a grid, and for you guys, this is not, activate the monolith. Though I'm not, not crazy about that. It told me to, because I was gonna do it anyway. Let me see if I can. I think that's always tricky. This thing between how much instruction to give the player.
Yeah, we had this discussion a lot, because at first there was nothing, and some people were very confused about is there really something to do or not.
Yeah.
So we decided that for the first, we will help the player, we'll make a bit smoother for the first things to do. We'll not tell the solution, but we'll make sure the player understands there is something to do. And then maybe for the later, then we will not say anything anymore.
So I wonder, I feel one issue with that is that you could end up building the wrong expectations, you know? Because for me, once you train the player that you don't tell them stuff, but they have to look for it, then they know in the future they have to look for it. Whereas if you do this first and then you take it away, people are like, hey, what's up with that?
That's the other way of seeing it. So, I guess it's more or less like a design choice.
Right.
What do you like? Would you accept losing some part of the player at first, or teaching them
Right.
I do think also later.
Some of that can just be visual solutions. What I'm thinking right now, and this is because I played that earlier build, and I think I played the earlier build two, three times. David says to cut the monolith. Can I do that? No. I'm just gonna try some. Oh, what the hell? Did something happen? Oh wait, maybe I can push that piece into it? Is that what's going on? Okay, so see, I was, I guess, just to clarify where I was thinking was, I think in the build I played at some point, so I played, the first time I played it, I walked around and built stuff. I didn't do anything. And
okay.
Then the sort of towards the end, I started to try to go very, very far into the distance and got to one of these. And what I did was I think I had to put a block into the middle, and that triggered something.
Yeah.
So it's not the cutting. It's I wonder if. So I kept thinking about a place to put the block, and I wonder if that might be a more. I mean, this totally makes sense, but I wonder if the block fitting in might be an easier opening one, just because I think the block insertion is a more, that's the one you are more likely to use.
Yeah. The thing is, like, I'm not telling you too much because as I told, maybe it's interesting for the people in the chat to know. But we had a build like last week, and we did a lot of playtests because we went to a festival, and so we see like how people react, and we changed a lot of things, and so it's the first time with some new features and some tweak. So William is the first one playing here. And the thing is, like, if I answer the question you're asking me right now, I will just kind of spoil you.
Right,
just trying to see what you're doing.
Yeah.
So this is why right now I'm not too much into, like because I think what you're saying is very accurate. And so so in the first time, I just want to see how you react to everything and what where you go, what you do. And so... like after you've done or not, then I can tell you
so
what we try to do.
I'm gonna cut. Interesting. Yeah, I'm just kind of speaking out loud.
Sure.
That is, yeah, because I think and just to kind of explain where I was coming from, because I was definitely looking for the block, a hole to put the block in, and then I just for a second I forgot I could do the cut and the push, but. I think that may have been just I don't know if it makes sense, like, because can I cut white stuff? Oh, those look lovely, by the way, those lines coming in. Alright, so I've activated the monolith. I'm gonna come here and look. I do love that I built that green bridge and was able to sort of walk to the back of it. And I see also now if I hold up jump, I... maybe if Fugan can answer some of this question. I was just wondering how you guys do the object generating for this, for the block. Is that a cube? Is that a pool that you are working in?
So maybe in the chat, Fugan will be able to explain like a bit more detail than me what we are doing about the generating the structures. But the thing is, like, we place the placing block, and they're like
all attached to it. Ah, okay, yeah. Ah, oh, right. This is, well, though, now that makes sense, and I think maybe if I just walked around a bit, that would all be clear. I think perhaps it's just a way of the ordering. Interesting.
Yeah, you came by, and then you decided to go on the left part. So, like, all three are just using the basic. Like three basic tools except the cleaning one.
Right.
So yeah, we placed the one with the block is the closest to where you come from. So most of the people go there. But I was like wondering, if you don't go there, will you like be able to smoothly do the other one? And will you be able to go back there? Like, so that's why I was not telling you too much about all this.
Right, yeah. No. And I really like this. I mean, I'm enjoying it tremendously. That was when, with the build tool, aim at a structure or a fragment you create and hit right click to pull yourself towards it.
Yeah, there's a lot of information in this sentence, but you have to use the build tool, and now you're using the cut tool.
Oh, so I see, the build tool, right. Okay, yeah. That's, it's like a 3D modeling software. Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, so you guys are not doing a pool. I do love the double jump. I don't know, did someone, I don't think you taught me that.
Excuse me?
I don't think the game taught me about the double jump.
Oh. Maybe.
I don't remember seeing it. I think I just discovered it.
Usually when you completed the first monolith, it was the before the glide you had the hyper jump.
Oh,
it was
I
like,
see. Okay.
But maybe it didn't appear. I didn't pay attention. But since we just changed it, maybe it didn't appear. But then if you hold the jump button, then you jump higher.
Right. So I think this is the kind of stuff I like to do. What the fuck? Am I walking on this? Oh, it doesn't let me build on this. I just want to see what happens. This is... I really love that I get to build these structures. It's actually... In a lot of ways, I'm actually very envious of this mechanic, because it feels very designed. Like, you know, I don't know, did you see the stuff about my the water system in my game?
Yeah, I saw the GIF.
Yeah, that was sort of kind of trying to create the same sense of feeling where you can use it to do stuff. Like, this wouldn't work for my game, just because it opens up too much. But I do think it's really... I'm gonna do it. This is the stuff that I'm gonna do anyway. Black is...
Yeah, we're totally fine with this. Like, actually the most interesting stuff we got, because all this is a setup for, like, of course, the player to learn about how the game works and everything,
yeah.
The mechanics. But the core of the game is just have fun with the toy. Just toy,
yeah,
with the game, like discover the emergent properties and things you can do. And so it's funny because sometimes we have like these people playing the game and they don't give a fuck about all the puzzle and anything. They just like go somewhere, build stuff, cut it, like make some like 100
yeah.
squares and just so. So that's what I enjoy watching the most.
Alright, I'm pretty sure that just goes up infinite and there's no way. But like what is really cool though is that I'm allowed to do it, you know? I mean, I think that's like... Like, I'm already excited about what's there and down there. Oh, wait a minute. Again, while in the air. Oh, interesting. Oh, that's what you're talking about. I can do like the, so I can do this double jump and then fly towards stuff. Oh, very cool. You guys have a really interesting navigation system that I'm a big fan of.
Yeah. The thing is, like, yeah, you have to combine all the different, like, movement tools you unlock. So you can like hyper jump, then you hold the glide and you can boost aiming while gliding, you can boost aiming at structures. That's the like fastest way to move.
And it's always with the pieces I created.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just in terms of production, do you guys have an idea of when things will be?
Yeah, we have to, like, we're running short on time, so we have to wrap everything. I think we have first version for the IGF deadline, so end of October.
I'm not even, I'm not submitting this year.
Oh, really?
So I hope you win.
I hope too, but the thing is, I think like early next year we'll release something.
Okay.
That's because we don't have much time anymore. So, or we find more money, more time, and we can go forever.
Have you guys thought of submitting this to IndieFund or Kickstarter?
I don't think we're going to Kickstarter or something like this, but yeah, maybe finding like more, like, how to say,
angel
like
investors?
Funding that let us do more or less what we want, like, freely.
Because I think the big advantage you have is you have a very solid demo and a very solid mechanic. That's already like a very clear idea. That just like even just the feedback loop of building this, I'm just having a tremendous amount of fun kind of building this stuff. What do you think are some of the issues that you guys have left that you guys are kind of interested in working on?
So I think that the first like 20% of the beginning of the game is pretty okay.
Yeah.
But right now we have a lot more like puzzle to make. Like we already designed it, but we have to. It takes a lot of time to tweak it until like it's like easy enough so people can understand, and it's hard enough so it's not like pointless to do. So we have a lot of like implementation left for the second part of the game, and also we are working on the narrative,
right?
Because it's not working so well right now. It's the part of the game we're not working on for a while, and we need to rework on this.
Did that thing disappear? I think I built into the sphere.
Yeah, you collected it.
Ah, okay. By building into it.
Oh, you just have to run into it, but you can, I guess you can build into it as well. Yeah. I don't think it would do anything.
And you play Minecraft?
Actually, personally, I never played Minecraft.
I've never played Minecraft either.
But, of course, I think Minecraft opened like a gate or like new perspective of like, okay, like it's actually fun to do this. So we had this first prototype, or we have just these blocks, like all these cubes that were attached to each other, and we could just cut the links between the block, and we'd cut the stuff, it fails, and because of the physics it felt a bit like some like bread, or it was like soft, and we thought like, oh, it's super cool, and we want to build on this, we want to keep going on this. So to answer like the Minecraft question is always tricky, because of course we cannot avoid the comparison.
That happens, you know, with people love to do that too.
And it's a way easier way of thinking of, okay, this game is a crossover between this and this. But actually the most important thing in this game is make the player feel like peaceful feeling and like experimentation and exploration without like being worried of like failing. That was the most important thing we wanted to convey. It's really cool.
You know who I think you should send this to is Chris Bell. Do you know him? Chris Bell.
Excuse me?
Do you know who Chris Bell is?
No.
He is. He was one of the designers on Journey, and he now works at Giant Sparrow. Giant Sparrow, they made Unfinished Swan. He's currently working on Edith Finch. He's based in L.A. He also made that game Way. It was like an early IGF. It was about like multiplayer interaction that led him to go work at that game company. But I think this is something that he would really enjoy and would have some really interesting thoughts about. But yeah, I can. I'll send an email. I think he would really like this.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, he gives really good feedback. And he's always about like player expression. I think Journey is a lot about that, right? It's like, how do you look at multiplayer interaction other than killing people? And I think this is just so much fun. Like, I'm like, even just looking back, I feel sort of very accomplished, and it's sort of very cool to see this. The weird thing about it, so David Kilmer says the weird thing about first person games is you don't often see what you just did, but here you have that all shown. I'm curious, how come I'm not having like a huge performance hit?
The thing is, like, we had like a lot of performance issue, but since we moved to like Unity 5, it helped a lot.
If you work on a game long enough, all your optimization problems are solved.
So that's the good part. But still, like, at some point, if you build forever, like structures of block, at some point your frame rate will be like one frame every 2 years. So
right.
This is why we have to implement some button to clean everything.
Right.
Because, like, we have the same problem. We have another problem. Like, if you build only one block and you cut it forever, you can like destroy your frame rate at the same. So with only one block.
Yeah, this is kind of cool. So, I just realized I can build stuff in the distance, which means that when I jump, I can do the. I can do the glide, which is sort of a really, really cool. Like, that wasn't taught to me, and now it's discovered for me, and I think it's really exciting. It is a very, I think in terms of the calmness factor, I think you guys have done a really fantastic job with it. Like, it's
Thanks. Yeah, that's the thing I'm very proud of. From like, there's many things I would have done differently or working so long on this game, but this is the thing I'm happy about. Like, just the player like put the headset, put the music, like everything is peaceful and you can like spend time. And finally, when you show the game to the festival, it's really hard because everyone is on a rush trying to play, like, and it's very hard to show this game because you need time, you need to be like in a quiet environment, and to be like alone, and so yeah, it's, I think it's the thing I'm happy about.
Yeah, like I think that's one thing I think you guys do really well. I think also probably because I don't have like music in my game right now, but the feedback I've always gotten with my game is it's very cold. Like, it's very, maybe it's a little better, but it's very cerebral, and it's more like this math science thing, whereas this is much more emotional, and I think that's really great, because that's really hard to do, but I think my game is also much more focused on systems and puzzles.
Yeah, I don't know much about, because every time I watch the stream or every GIF, like, I never actually saw or played the game. So I don't know exactly what is the I know about the gravity switching and everything, but I don't know how much it, like, it's in the core of every puzzle and everything you need to do. But what I saw, I don't agree about the like cold feeling, because I think the gradients you have from every corner looks really like, makes everything like warmer. But the thing is, I agree with you, that we had the build at some point, we had no music, and the game was like horrible to play. Like, you were in this like giant environment, all white, and you had no music, and every second feel like 1 minute, and you were like, oh, when will I arrive there? And suddenly we plugged the music, and it was like, oh, it's cool. It's like, it doesn't matter if it takes time to go there, it's like, okay. And so, yeah, it makes a huge, huge difference. Like, I think it's more than 50% of the feeling of your game come from the audio, because it's way more evocative than the what you see. So. Like, will you like compose the music yourself for?
I don't think so. I'm still not sure about that, because there's a lot of really interesting audio stuff I want to do. The actual gravity switching is actually not quite as important as the world wrapping. So, like, a lot of stuff, what I want is to have it, you know, we have the world repeats itself, and if we have an offset, I want it so That means if you make a sound, you hear it come from behind you as well.
Oh.
So that there's very, like, I think that would be a very cool thing to have. Yes, Garlando Bloom is right. Main thing, I do need to start working on audio soon. But so it basically requires a sort of like actual physics system in the way we are doing the audio. Do you guys have, so tell me how many people are on the team?
We are 8 right now.
Oh, 8. Okay. And you have...
So it sounds like a lot, but as I told you, since we're working, we have like, most of the people have a job or...
Yeah.
So it doesn't let that much time.
And then just, so you're French and you've been living in Korea for a few years now?
Yeah, as well as been like, we'll be like 1.5 year.
Okay.
And yeah, I was like, it was a good time to move here because I knew that I will work on this game and I could work like from Korea because some of the people were living in the States or in Canada at the time.
Yeah.
So in the team, so I was like, okay, let's try to make a like online. So we had this funny meeting or the weekly meeting. It was like, for me, it started at 10 p.m. like every Saturday, and it started like in California time. It was like 6 a.m. So we had this funny like time gap. it was pretty hard.
Did the whole team meet? In school in France?
5 people, like we were 5 from the same school and we started the game together as 5 as the like end of like the graduation game. And after we were joined, like one, the person who would do the music is one of my friends, and he was like, oh, I have this really like cool game, would you like to do the music for it and do all the sounds, because I really like his ambient like music style. So he joined, and then we had like another person for working on the environment. So he did like most of like all, maybe 98% of all the environment was did by this person, and we had another person that joined for the like cinematics.
And then your role is designing the mechanics,
Yeah, it's hard to tell, but my role is like making sure everything goes all right, and like I mostly like take care of the like the art direction, and also I'm like organizing all the meeting, like make sure everyone's like know what it has to do and is no problem. So I try to do everything that. Like the thing is, like I found people that are better than me in everything.
Right.
So I cannot do like most of the things anymore because they're better than me. So I just like assist them in doing the things I would like to do. But they're like, so that's what I'm doing.
That's important. You always want to hire people who are smarter than you.
And the thing is, like we're all working, like we all starting working. Like because we like the concept, and everyone works because it's very like into it, and there is no like high, like there is nobody like paid right now, and so it's a very good, like I'm very happy about this. I feel it's really cool, and like we're very lucky being able to all do something we like and we love and we believe in together, spending some time doing this, and this is why we're like we haven't like got. We didn't do the Kickstarter or anything because we just wanted like, okay, we have time right now, we have like we can do the thing as we want, we don't have to tell like to involve anyone else in the designing process. So
no, that's and I think that's really important. I think a game like this sort of needs that time, you know, because I feel I'm in a very similar situation myself, and definitely a game. It needs a time for it to mature and
the thing is like it's the first game, like this big game we're doing, and And I think when we started, we didn't expect the game to be so big, like this big. And so it took a lot of time to just like understand what we were trying to do. And
yeah.
And we need like we did a lot of mistakes. We wasted a lot of time. But I think we had to do this. We had to we can understand what was working in, or how to translate what we want to do in a game.
Yeah. You know what the thing I just noticed? This boost screen has been there the whole time.
Because you didn't complete this. Like you have to do one more like glide boost.
Ah, okay.
So you have to place a block in front of you anywhere, and you jump, you glide, and you boost at it.
I think like I'm aiming too far out.
Yeah, maybe. I think nobody never been there before.
This is always where I go. Every time I see a border, I run towards it.
So I'm just letting you like go, whatever.
Yeah.
But maybe, since you're maybe the first one we see going there, maybe you cannot build anymore. Or
I couldn't put anything on the ground. Like it has to be on this white. Pause the stream. So this is, I don't know if there's anyone new here, but Arnold Venier, he's a designer on Bokita. And if you like the stream, you should follow the channel. We are checking out Bokita. Because I remember looking at your portfolio and I like, you have a very clean aesthetic in almost all of your work. it's sort of like showed this white base and then kind of these very soft colors. Watesiwa, and then I think you also had the other one where you're flying around. I forget the name.
Yeah, Inside.
Inside.
Yeah, it's true. The thing is like I'm not good at drawing. I'm not good at like 3D. I'm not good at anything. And also I'm very like passionate about the lights, about like the light installation and everything about like, for instance, when you walk in the city and you have this like sunlight like projecting on the building, it feels so warm, it feels so good. And so most of the thing I try to like replicate this feeling in games. So most of the game are like abstract first person because I cannot make any models for like character, so there is no character most of the time, or it's just an abstract shape. And also the environment has to be very simple because I cannot make like complicated stuff. And I think it's good, like I like this constraint, like being bad and try to make something I'm satisfied with, even if I cannot do much. So this leads to have this aesthetic of very like minimal. So actually, you were like heading, you were going to the right way. I think like when you were building the door at the monolith, and then you fell at some point.
Yeah.
But that was definitely the next place to go.
But I saw that, and I've just kind of like, it's very easy to, it's easy to remember where you are. And I am, I think the one thing that's bothering me a bit now is sort of the inconsistency of where I can build. Like, I can't do it on the ground, I can do it here. And I'm definitely feeling the frame rate hit.
Oh, you have?
It is sort of a little bit lagging.
Oh, it's nice to see, okay.
But it's like, I've been playing for some time. It just feels slower, a little bit more sluggish. Yeah, like David Kimmer says, constraint is the key.
Oh, and you completed the boost.
Yeah,
the
I did that. And, so right now in Korea, are you working at a game studio?
No. I'm just doing this.
Ah, okay.
I'm just working on Bokita. So I'm working on like French schedule, so I work like most of the time from 9 p.m. to like 3 or 4 in the morning to be like able to be like on Skype or TeamSpeak with my friends, so we can like work together.
And why Korea? Like how'd you
Because my wife is Korean.
Okay, I see.
thought it was the easy like reason.
Right.
and also like, I never lived outside, so it was the good opportunity to move away from the country I know and discover new things.
Oh, I think one thing, just visually, one thing that happens is with this outline, like it works really well when it's up close, but you can notice when it's here that it starts to not be lined up correctly with the blocks, and it sort of forms this like little dots. You see what I'm saying? Like it's no longer aligned with where the it's not a very big issue. But I just kind of wanted to point that out. Very cool. Yeah, you should definitely. I think Chris Bell would really like this. Oh, you know what thing I think that would be kind of cool is lighting noise. Like when you're gliding to maybe hear some sound like whoosh.
Oh yeah.
I think just so there's you know when you're gliding.
Yeah, there's a lot of missing sound effects. Rhino, there's like most of the music are done, but most of the sound effects are not done yet.
So you
lack a lot of feedback and signs to
David Kimmer says he also works on French time as well, except he's in the U.S.
What? Why?
I guess he's close to just a night owl. Fugain also talks about some of the main problems is the edges the main problems with the edges detection. Although I don't think you're using edge detection when you are using this. I'm pretty sure that's just a texture.
Yeah, it's a texture.
Yeah, it's just a texture. I think it's just far away that it does. And this is where I think the temporal anti-aliasing would help as well.
Yeah, maybe we can also make it like the thickness is screen like related, so you get a bit thicker if it's like further, so it's still clean.
Have you guys thought of VR for this? I'm sure. People have asked that.
Sort of what?
VR.
Oh, VR. No, never. I think we never talked about this.
Oh, really? I get people ask me to do VR for my game all the time. I haven't tried.
Oh, really?
I think right now, right now with these spheres, it's a bit of a. What is the point of these spheres?
The thing is, like, all these are related to a mechanic that is. Not implemented yet.
As I told you,
you like right now you can build like infinitely. You have no limit on building, but normally you have this bar at the top left part of the screen, and it's getting like empty as you're building, and so you will have to do some specific things to refill it, like for instance absorbing some blocks that you have cut it. And you have these dots just on the right of the bar. You have this square.
I see that,
And this is what you collect. And when you collect 10 of these, then you have a new like segment for the bar, so it's bigger, so you can build more. And so it's like the mechanics. Because right now, one of our problem is like you spent like almost an hour on the game, and you haven't cut anything so far, almost. This is like, this is something that is important for us because we think most of the fun also comes from cutting stuff because it's like the physics, and so we want to include the cutting inside the core loop of the game, which is like building stuff to help you go where you want to go. So that was our solution, but since we haven't found yet a good way of like teaching the player how it works, so it's the relation between like when you build your bar getting empty and you have to refill your bar with cutting and absorbing. Like I think if you cut a structure, I can show you like
Let's cut this stuff you, in front.
Yeah. If you cut it, you have to go close to the what you're cutting, but if you're like looking at red, if you're like close to red blocks, and if you do right click with the cut, maybe it works. I'm not sure.
Am I supposed to be right clicking?
So it was is deactivated, but like the idea was like this. You go and you can collect the red fragments and you like remove the color from them and it refill your building bar. And it becomes white. White.
I think I like that more than the orb collection, because that this feels like the. I feel like the problem with the orb collection is you end up being like a pixel hunting thing where you look for and then you walk and also because you're looking for those when you are out of you can't build, right? So you end up having to walk to the black orbs. You know what I mean? Like.
Yeah, but I think the fact that you cannot build on the gray ground like kind of the sea.
Yeah.
It's just like we forgot to tag the ground so people can build on.
But I mean just like in terms of if you were making it with that black orbs where you had it such that you couldn't build anymore and you had to go get a black orb. Is that sort of what you were talking about?
No, it's all is together. Like you cannot build, but you can refill your bar whenever you want. But still, if you want your bar to be bigger, you will need to collect.
I understand now. Okay.
And every time you collect 10 of them, you have a new part of the bar. At the end, you have like kind of infinite building.
Right.
It was the easy way for us because we have so many places that we want the player to go, but not so many rewards. And it was like easy reward. Like, okay, you went there, you got this, you will be able to build more. It's not a big thing, but it's still like a... us saying to the player, okay, you went there, you get something that someone who will not have otherwise, and it was like we're rewarding you for like exploring. Because it was like,
sorry, go on.
In the first build of the game, in the very first, we had this environment, another one, but it was like kind of the same feeling, but we had nothing into it, and so a lot of player was frustrated because there was like all this like big mountain and it was like, okay, I will go at the top of the mountain. Then they spent a lot of time going there, and when they're at the top, there is nothing. So they were like, oh well, it was like, so I think just a little something might help making them feel like, okay, there were something. The designer knew they were like, some people might go there, and by going there you would get something that you would not get otherwise.
Acknowledging what the player did.
Exactly, it's like we know, we just thank you for like going there and, you know.
Right, so there's two things. One, I think I'm noticing like with these little artifacts here.
Yeah.
I believe that is what the cheer maneuver, my solution, addresses, which is essentially, and I don't know, perhaps Fugan can talk a bit more about the edge detection. I don't know if you guys are doing... It looks to me like you are doing depth-based edge detection and not normals. And I think... So, actually, in that case, it might not work. But I think it's just the way you want to sample the pixels and not compare them. If you dive deep into it, you can sort of compare the pixels... If you sort of look at where the sampling is, you can figure out when it's a false positive and when it is a true one. And I think that would be yours is a little bit different because mine relies on everything being these like very 90 degrees. But I think that same approach should be able to fix these little artifacts here for you. Because if I...
Yeah, we have a lot of this.
Yeah. If I look correctly, it looks... Oh, no, wait. Yours is a different... Never mind. I take that back. Yours is a different problem. Because your looks like... You know what it is? Oh, you know what? It's all this is because you have, like, a slight surface in the middle. But if you didn't have that, then it'd be fine, right?
Most of the problem is because of the 3D modernization. Yeah. Sometimes we have like a tiny gap, or we have
That's all it is, actually. So I take that back. My solution is different. My solution is hidden faces on the inside, but yours is just a gap in the...
But it takes a lot of time to clean, because whenever we have to find one, we have to check everything.
Right.
And there's a lot of back and forth.
Yeah. Although, then I wonder if maybe with the way you do edge detection, where if you had just a bigger sampling, you could then not have that. Or if you did just pure ambient occlusion.
The thing is, like, we had at the first, like, we had the edge detection on the, like, around the player, not in the background. But the background looks like pretty dull, so we added another one that is way like lighter, very thinner and lighter on the background. And I think it's part of the aesthetic of the game. Like, it's so into like since the beginning that we are not considering like removing the edge detection. It gives it helps a lot also reading the. So I think we'll stick with the edge detection till the end.
Just kind of clean it a bit.
Yeah, we need to. Yeah, that's what we need. In the door you build.
Here you're seeing.
Yeah. True.
Yeah. So your problem is a very different one than mine. Which I feel like larger sampling size would fix it. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, I think that's more. Yeah, it's interesting. It's a very different situation. It just has to do with. But David Kilmer asks, is there a limit with the gliding? I haven't really noticed one. I'm able to glide pretty far. Like, it does slow down after a while, but I can almost like point anywhere far out and kind of move.
What is the question?
He asked if there's a limit to a distance limit to the gliding.
The gliding or the boost? Gliding, there is no limit. Like, you just hold the press bar, and you can like you fold slower, and there is no limit. And you have some acceleration based on. So in here, you have to like open the door you build it, like.
Oh, the one I built, I have to cut it.
Yeah, cut or clean, whatever.
You did teach me that early on.
Yeah, but it's not that clear yet, because we removed one step. We had like two steps of confirmation in the tutorial and one step here that is just like I'll remember this.
Yeah, I'm now that you told me, but it is. Yeah, I think that's a really it's an interesting solution. It's a problem, which is that people don't tend to cut a lot, right?
Yeah,
they
yeah.
want to build. But cutting is just as important, and I do remember learning to do this.
You need like I think here we have also a problem something we haven't solved yet. You can only push what is red, that is all what is physically applied, and the thing is like it's super hard to cut here because the gate that was behind here. How to explain? It's hard to explain, but yeah, it's super hard to cut here, and it should be way easier.
Wait, can you explain the difference between the yellow and the red cuts?
The thing is, like, yeah, when you place a block, it's green.
Yeah.
And when you cut it, like the part that is physically applied is becoming red, and the part that is not is becoming yellow. And being yellow means you cannot build on it anymore, but it's not physically like there's no physics on it.
Why?
So
how
when
do you
push,
separate when it's red, when it's yellow? Why aren't all the pieces red?
Excuse me?
Like, why isn't it when you cut, all the pieces are red? I don't understand the yellow-red split.
The thing is, like, it's a difference for... It's a... Like, all... The yellow is this... The... Belongs to the block. It's a block that is cutted, but it's not... physically applied, so you cannot push it, you cannot move it. It's the same as a green block. And the red part are all the chunks that are like, you cut it and are like physics applied on the blocks.
But how do you split it inside the game? Like how can I know before I cut it which part is going to be red?
That's the big problem we have right now for other puzzles as well,
right.
Is you cannot really tell. You have to understand how it works. You have to, like, by experience, by right. experimenting, you will understand. But basically, what the system is when you cut a block, the part, like, you have the center of the block, the part with the center of the block will stay yellow, and all the, like, corner you cut will become red.
I see. But by the way, I noticed when I was coming into this room, the frame rate dropped quite a bit. I think it's because you were doing asynchronous level loading.
So your frame rate is better, Rhino?
It is better, but just when I was coming down the stairs into this room, when I was going down.
Yeah, because there's like a portal. Yeah. It's,
I have that same problem. Is this world wrapping?
Yeah. We had this, like, this is why I wanted to show you this as well. It's like only vertical, like wrapping, like, I think when we started the game, like in 2013, we had this first, one of the first demo was like using like how do you say, non-Euclidean spaces, like you enter a room and you end up outside. And when you get, like, in some specific places, you end up, but not related, like, there is, you know, like, it's like we're using, like, double rooms to teleport the player.
Yeah.
And so, and for a long time after this, we get, like, we put this idea apart, and now we have, like, some time, so we have these different places in the world with different rules. So this one is, like, vertical wrapping, but
and
you have another one that is another room.
My things for me, right? Like, my blocks keep turning red automatically.
Because in this room, like, this is not finished yet. It's far from being, like, playable, like, easily understood by a player, because it lacks a lot of scene and feedback. But here is a place where specific rules, where in this place, whenever you place a block, whenever you place a block after a certain time, it explodes.
Right.
So this is why whenever you place a cube, then after like few seconds, you see the cube like becoming red and moving from like to a direction. Yeah. Because
I keep seeing it falling too. This is pretty amazing.
Fuck. Yeah, so everything
is
looping.
This is really cool. Ah, oh, damn.
So I wanted to. So I'm happy you went there because you're one of the first person to experiment this.
It's really magical. I actually think it's almost done better than in my game. I mean, my
you
game
know
very
well about this.
My game's very, it takes a much more cerebral, and this is a very, very, like, mine, you have to sort of use it to solve puzzles, right? Like, I have to, like, throw a block off and then come back here, and then you can do it in all these different directions, but this is done in a way that's like very much more about the feeling, and then just having these things fall is really very beautiful.
The thing is, like, I think you know very well what are the advantages of word wrapping. Is I think the thing is, like, when you want to build something very big but you don't want the player to move forever to go somewhere, that the like making the feeling of huge and being able to go somewhere very fast, that's the best solution. And also in this place, we want to teach the player to glide, use the glide, use the boost. So it's like, okay, you cannot build, and we want the player to go somewhere.
Yeah.
And we want the player to fail. Like, you cannot jump from one island to another. You have to fall. You can. So, but because it's like wrapping, it doesn't matter, right? So that was like the easiest solution of like safe place to experiment flying, kind of gliding,
right,
where like you can always reach your destination because it's just a matter of like how long you will fall and when will you start gliding. And I think it's like what you did in your game as well, like when I was reading the Indiecape feedback you got, and it's really true that it feels really big, but you can, I don't know, I never played the game, but from what I understand, you can go like anywhere pretty fast. And also you can use the, in your game that is not in our, your game is like, you can use what you see as a map of where you want to go.
Yeah.
That's not the case in this example, because we don't wrap the like horizontal. But how many cookies do you have? Because just making this was like a lot of camera, like copy of camera. But you are doing like so many copies of your like logo. So I was like, how can you do it like performance wise?
Right. So a lot of them happen to have a typical one will be like 5x5x5. So that'll be a 125 grid. We do have to end the stream soon.
Okay.
But it's been almost an hour and a half. But the one thing is we have a very long view distance. Like, I think it's... Do you know what your view distance is? Mine's about 1,000.
I think we have like few kilometers. Like, not here, because here we don't like... Oh, it's the same, but we in the main game, the far clip, I think, is around like maybe 5 kilometers.
Oh, okay. So yeah, that's pretty big. Like mine's, yeah, so I have quite a lot of copies, and it is a big performance issue. Are you just duplicating all these objects?
No, it's like a camera. We use the camera. We copy the...
Oh, it's right.
Yeah. We just copy the camera. Like, in fact, we don't use only one camera to render the 5,000 meter. We have like three different.
Oh, interesting. We should talk.
I think what we do here is we just copy the view. So we just copy the camera and put it
but
like.
Aren't you getting? But if you just copy the camera, what happens? Don't you lose the perspective? Like, don't you not get parallax?
Yeah, you see, there is four copy camera on top and bottom of the player.
Oh, see, okay, yeah. So this is I think the hard part for me to tell is because your world isn't very along a grid. I have an actual, you know, 5x5x5 grid of the same object, so it looks, and it's a little clearer. Man, I'd love to kind of continue this conversation. Because like with yours, these are more like random shapes that it's a lot harder for me to tell where it's starting and where it's ending.
I don't know about the deformation because there is no like clear grid in these settings.
Because for us, we also like we eventually start to do offsets and we start to rotate the world. So when you fall down one version, the world is inverted. And you can, if you like, that means like if you drop a box off in one instance, I will see it in the second one, I will see it fly up. So the directions change. Interesting. I'm very, very curious about this. Anyway, let's end the stream here. I think this is a really great point. I think everyone got a good sense of Bokita. Again, I think your game is wonderful, and it's something I'm very excited about. I feel like we have both, like, I think both Manifold Garden and Bokita have very similar aspirations and themes, but totally addressed very, very differently.
So, like, whenever, like, I was very happy to be able to talk to you, but... Like, if you want to spend more time about how we do the things and how you do the thing technically, or just discuss about that, I would be glad to have more conversation with you.
And and you should. I think Chris Bell would really. Do you guys have plans of coming to US for GDC next year, or?
I think I'll try to be as much event as possible. So.
Okay. If you know, GDC is always a really, really great event to sort of meet everyone. Anyway, so this is Arnold Van Eer, Bokita. That's the game. You can check it out at it's on Twitter, Bokita Game and BokitaGame.com, Bokita.com. I do think I think a lot of people here are into my game. and I think this is something that you should definitely keep an eye out for. So I'm going to end the stream here, but yeah, thanks so much for taking the time to come on the stream and talk and share the game.
Thanks for sharing your feedback playing the game, and that's great, man.
Yeah, and Fugen, Blurky as well. Thanks for joining the chat, and thank you everyone who is here. I will. Yeah, let's continue talking, and I will see you later. All right, peace. Alright, just a second. Alright, ending the stream. Next week we're gonna dive into temporal anti-aliasing, and we'll be doing that more. We'd love to bring back Bokita for another stream. So I'll talk to you guys later.